be here, and I've had the privilege of presenting at this conference for a couple of years now, and it's always a treat to be asked to come back and talk with you all. And today we're going to be talking about workforce. And can everybody hear me? Okay. And specifically, my part of the presentation is going to be focused on safety in the workforce. And how many of you all are employers out here? Okay, so just about everybody is an employer. So as Peter said, I work up in Anacortes, and I run the Center of Excellence for Marine Manufacturing and Technology. And though I'm home-based at Skagit Valley College Marine Tech Program in Anacortes, the Center of Excellence is a statewide entity. So I work with industry and educational institutions on a statewide level. All of the Centers of Excellence do that. There are 10 that are focused on key industry sectors for the state of Washington. The one I represent is marine. As you might guess, we have aerospace, energy, construction, and so on. All of them are at a community or technical college. All of them are statewide, and that's a very important point. But for today's conversation, and we'll kind of come back to that statewide issue in a second, safety and workforce training, these are not two mutually exclusive things. And as we prepare on the educational side, the workforce that hopefully you all are going to hire, and these folks are hopefully going to be very successful within your companies, we look at a number of different things in addition to just training on the most current technology, just making sure the students have the technical competencies and the certification that they need to enter the workforce successfully. We also look at issues around sustainability, and I was sorry I couldn't be here yesterday because I know there was a fantastic session on sustainability. But we also look at safety, and that's what I'm going to focus on for the next several moments. And so our students come out with several credentials, all with safety embedded in them. Our entire curriculum has safety embedded within it. Where I work, we also share space with the High School Skills Center. So I have the opportunity to work with the K-12 component as well to help them with curriculum safety issues too. So at the high school level, these students are being exposed to safety within their curriculum. When they get into the post-secondary level, whether it's at a college, an apprenticeship program, or some other training program, safety is part of that as well. When I work with colleges around the state who want to either start or expand their marine trades training, and I'm working with a group of colleges right now in South Puget Sound, one of the first questions I get is how much is it going to cost to buy the equipment and get all the bells and whistles that we need? And my initial response to them is don't forget about the safety core. That's what we call it. That has to be part of your training. So when we help with professional development for instructional faculty, when we help, and by that, when the Centers of Excellence help locate equipment and work with companies like DEREMA, you know, to do workshops, we want to make sure the safety piece is always part of that. And that's kind of that's the culture that we try to create at the educational level so that when that student comes out and they come to you and apply at your yard or your place of business, your marina, for employment, you can have some confidence that that student has a basic fundamental understanding of what it means to be a safe employee. Because we're just like you all. You know, we might not be selling generators, we might not be painting boats, we might not be working on engines as a business enterprise, but we have liability issues too. So within the program, and then when I work with other colleges to start programs, we want to have a program where the student comes in and for all intents and purposes, it's just like being in the real world, in an actual working shop. We've been very fortunate to have high enrollments. The interest in the industry is extremely high. So we've got large numbers of students. We've got really fun and exciting and potentially dangerous equipment. And how do you balance that out? And I'm very proud to say that with all the programs that I work with that have adopted this culture of safety, the safety records are extremely high, which is great. So the standards that we teach to equal safety. And I'm not going to read this list, but as you can see, the students really, if they're supervised, just like you would supervise a new employee in your yard, they have to use personal protective equipment. They've got to be aware of the hazards at all times. And then again, as I was just saying, all of the safety content is embedded in the curriculum. So though we do OSHA 10, we do forklift, we do first aid, we have specific classes on safety. When you get into your applied math class, or you go into your composite tooling class, or your, you know, your outboard engine class, it doesn't mean that you leave safety behind the other door. That's all part of the curriculum. And that's what we're excited to talk to you about today. So, and what we're doing is working with a lot of K-12 schools and getting that type of programming in for those kids at the high school level, so that when they come into a post-secondary program, they're prepared and they're a little bit ahead of the game so that they can get out of their program faster and get to work for all of you faster. And the other part of this too, and I almost forgot to mention this, that would have been terrible. So safety for the student, safety in the workplace, but also the awareness of the student for the end user and consumer. Because at some point, whether they're working for you or maybe, whether or perhaps they hang out their own shingle and they're entrepreneurs, you've got to keep in mind the customer, the end user of that product. A lot of safety issues around that. So sometimes the students grumble a little bit, and I'm sure you've heard your employees grumble a little bit about that. But we're really proud of what we've done, and we've got plans to expand the safety as well. So for us, those two things go hand in hand. And I think I'm about, am I good on time? Okay, these guys are a lot more interesting than I am. But this sort of sets the stage. And as Peter said, I would invite you to come up to Skagit Valley College anytime. The Marine Tech program is in Anacortes. Or if you're in an area that's not near Anacortes, but you're interested in programming in your community, either at your high school or at your local community or technical college, that's part of my job to be a resource for that type of thing. Please let me know, and we can make arrangements to have a meeting and work with the local resources that you have to find out how we can bring that type of training into your area. So I think with that, I'm done, and I'm going to turn it over to Derek. Or Dave.
Okay. We'll make the clumsy transition to... I'm Dave Gehring. I'm the Executive Director of the Manufacturing Industrial Council of Seattle. We have just, 6 months ago, ran into the Northwest Marine Trade Association, as Peter was describing. Looks like just a trip.
I know.
We do have a video. is there a way to show the PowerPoint first, or? So, we are partnering with Northwest Marine Trade Association on CORE Plus. This is an in-school program, not after school. It's basically bringing back a 21st century industrial arts curriculum for the state of Washington. It is aimed primarily at juniors and seniors in high schools, but there's some locations where they're doing a middle school component. The dream is to have a program of study where you would be involving kids at a young age and give them a whole step through their skill training exposure. The Manufacturing Industrial Council, we're an industrial business association based in Seattle. A lot of people you've probably run into through the years, mom and pop, family-owned companies, B&G Machine, Capital Industries, and the Maritime World, Pacific Fisherman Shipyard, Alaska Marine Lines, Boeing Company, BNSF, you know, the Nucor Steel. Pretty good cross-section of everybody. And We have been engaged in this with someone that Scott Dorica got to meet last week, Randy Dorn, who's the Superintendent of Public Instruction for the state of Washington. 3 years ago, this was a padlocked, darkened, rodent-infested room at Rainier Beach High School. Nobody knew how long the machine shop had been closed, but it had been closed forever, and through Core Plus, we were able to reopen it. This started, 3 years ago this fall. That's the teacher, Chris Names. The student in the middle is named Cade. Day after high school graduation, he got a job at ASCO Processing, an aerospace parts maker in Seattle. Jimmy Lamb on the right just started in August at Washington State University. Kay Duro, the young woman there, was by far the best student in the first program. She's starting her sophomore year at the University of Washington now. She's on the fast track to get into engineering. It turned out we didn't know that. Kay is a four-point student. Far and away the best machinist in the class. She's in a sorority. She is the only member of her sorority who knows how to weld, operate a milling machine. Hey, Kay's not going to have a gender pay gap in her lifetime. We got her a summer job at Breit Production Tooling out in the Kent Valley, and she just was wonderful. So Dallas Burke, he graduated this year in June. He got a job in July at Washington Chain, who some of you might know. His starting pay was $16.23 an hour. He had a benefit package of about $5. So this is an 18-year-old kid with a $21-$22 an hour compensation package based on what he learned in high school. Say that there's a lot of educators who are going to tell you, well, that's not possible. They can't learn enough stuff in high school to be employable. Well, they absolutely can, or they can learn enough to help promote their, you know, their academic career options, go on to the kind of programs that Ann's helping to create and sustain and make better in community college, four-year schools. One of the kids that you'll see in the video, if we have time to show it, is named Lucky Malarkey. He literally is at Cal Maritime. He started this fall based on what he learned in an airframe mechanic curriculum at Rainier Beach High School. There's 30 Core Plus programs in the state of Washington. This started only in 2012 as a school item, so there's been some really rapid growth. We think by the end of this year there'll be 41 programs around the state, and it'll be available to students from about 150 high schools because of the skill center model high school. Core Plus is a huge strategic link with safety. Core Plus is all based on what are called knowledge, skills, and abilities that are identified by the private sector. This all started because Boeing came forward to the state in about 2011, willing to identify KSAs for about 5 entry-level positions in aircraft manufacturing. We were brought into this to start validating that with other industries. You know, so take the name off, forget about the curriculum book, just what do you need them to know? And it was pretty darn amazing, because when he went through the airframe mechanic stuff, about 90% of it's applicable to absolutely everybody. Everybody. All the companies that I mentioned before, we've had about 30 companies engaged in this at a pretty high level of detail. You get to the end, and on the aircraft manufacturing stuff, it's being able to drill a perfect hole 1,000 times in a row. Everybody needs to know how to drill a perfect hole. Not every industry needs you to be able to drill 1,000 of them perfectly every time. 1,000 times in a row. Huge certificate-based potential. We took the names off of the KSA, so nobody knew. Some of these came out of proprietary programs, like Ann was talking about certificates. What these kids are able to learn through this program is totally consistent with these professional certificates that'll come later in their time. Safety, this is just so critical with maritime. We are starting a maritime emphasis this year to be able to get the kids out on the water. The school people are all going to be secretly terrified of that. There's groups. We're talking to Derek, and I know Derek's colleague is here. The key thing is we've got groups out there that get kids on the water all the time. So the key is to get them connected there, get them out of the school system for that experience, so you don't have to deal with the school district lawyer or the superintendent who doesn't want to go to the school district lawyer, you know, and they just go into a brain freeze, and get these kids out on the water. You got folks who know how to handle the liability for that. Safety, whether it's in the shop, it's exactly like what Ann was saying. This stuff all starts with safety. I mean, that's the first part of the curriculum. I'm a grandpa. I don't want to see any kid get hurt. As employers, you want to have this inculcated in them. So I think with you guys, just like, and I know Derek from years past, just like with airplanes, getting the kids up in the air, no school district will want to do that. There's tons of organizations out there that take kids for airplane rides for free. So it's just making that connection. That's why I'm motivated really to be here today, and I think it's kind of the strategic value that we all share. The plus part of this, in our state, actually, Core Plus is already being used in a number of these. Aircraft manufacturing and maintenance, marine manufacturing and repair, specialty trade construction. This is all plumber and pipe fitter stuff. Many of you know what I mean by that. Agricultural support services, there's two schools right now using this in Eastern Washington, these Core Plus KSAs to teach irrigation systems, building feed systems. You know, when you break it down, it's all pretty much the same. And then it gives some really nice topical content labels for some real basics in composites, metal fabricating, machining, eventually electronics, power plants, if we get to that someday. I'll flash through these pretty fast. There's a huge volume of this stuff in the state of Washington. We have about 92% of the manufacturing jobs that we had 20 years ago. We're probably one of the few states in the union that can say that. The business growth, like you guys are familiar with, lots of places have fewer people, but the business growth in these industrial sectors has been really steady. Nothing's gone away. And you're really talking about real significant growth in revenue and in skill levels in some of the areas for the jobs. In some of them, it hasn't changed in 100 years. And some of them, you really do need to learn new stuff. These kids are really capable of learning it. And one of the reasons I started with the personal stories is just there's kind of a fiction out there that, well, the kids aren't mature enough. They can't do this anymore. We want to get the entry-level worker when he's 30 years old. You'll hear that from some of the big, heavy industrial users. And then post-secondary, there's no reason in their business model to care how old the student is because the tuition's going to be the same anyway. There's no bonus for getting a young student. There's no penalty if you have an older one. But the problem right now is our entry-level folks getting into a lot of these programs they're in their late 20s, early 30s. It does not work for that person. You are going to get all the entry-level wages possible. You know that. You're all employers. What you're losing is the 10 or 15 years at the end of your career when you should be making the most money. That's when you're going to pay for the fact that from 18 to 30, you were couch surfing, working at McDonald's, trying to find yourself, didn't know what to do. Okay? And as a nation, there's just a huge strategic cost to this. We can't afford, as a major industrial power, with a really robust military, with meat eater industry, we can't afford to have people giving up 25% of their lifetime capacity. You just can't do it. It's not a good, there's no business model for this. I've talked to Scott about it. That's the frustrating thing. How do we make this work for K-12? It's the last compulsory part of our society, if you think about it. I mean, now that the draft's gone, they have to go to these schools. So the school doesn't have to invent something that makes the kids come to school. They just, show up, and they're required to. And then that breaks down when we get into post-secondary, and now what are you going to opt to do later? So we got to find a way, although we don't have a business model to do it, of getting the younger and kids engaged sooner. What we have found, about 114 of the kids have filled out a pretty extensive survey who have gone through Core Plus. These kids are real predisposed. They're gearheads. 90% of them by the end say, I found what I want to do. For 50% of them, I don't want to do anything else. Low-income kids, a program like this in high school, they've got adults typically in their life, somebody, a mom, a dad, an aunt, an uncle, a coach who thinks you got to do something in high school that's going to actually add to your repertoire in life, not just sort of cruise through and then, go off to college. And then full spectrum of skills, just like you saw. I mean, we have got everybody from the world beater academic types who love coming in and learning with their hands to the kids who are really struggling in school, but maybe have some good orientation to work. Value all learning. So I'm trying to fit into your format, and I do have a video. Do we have time to show the video? I don't want to.
I think so, yeah.
Sometimes the video will show it in a way that I can't. But I'm happy to stay here afterwards, answer questions.
Like good opportunity for like free college classes.
It all seems too complicated, and I just wanted to prepare myself to live my whole life.
I want to work for a living.
Oh, yeah, that's
shop program in middle school. And at first I wasn't too into it. I mean, I wasn't too into the metals aspect of it. That really just kind of scared me because it was, you know, big machinery. But later in the year, I really got into it. And by the time, you know, I got into it, the school year was over, and we came here, given Mr. Royal, did the internship program, and now Mr. Johnson, machine. It's been fun.
It's just, I want to work fast.
In the field, like in the engineering field, science field, you don't see a lot of women in this industry, and I kind of want to change that. Well, when I first came to this class, there was all guys, and I was shocked. And I told my mom about it, and I said I want to drop out, but once I got to hang with it, it was really fun. And it wasn't more of I'm the only girl here, it was more of what I can learn and like the new things I can experience.
This is the kid who got into Cal Maritime. So I hope we can be back next year, and we'll tell you how we did on the next 12 months developing the Marine Technology Program, which we hope to have as a replicable, doable unit that's being taught in just the same way that the airframe mechanic piece is being taught right now. But just bottom line, safety, 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 get the kids on the water. That's just, we all know that's a great thing to do. And then the beauty of this is then plug them into school. You know, get that exploratory, inspiring, wow factor experience and give them a next step. Now, that it'll take us years to really get that fleshed out, but it is happening. These programs, we started, like I said, 3 years ago, there were none of these. You know, now there's about 30. There'll be 40 of these programs by the end of the year. Kids from 150 high schools will be able to do it. So hopefully we can really, with your guys' help, beef up, and gals, beef up that marine technology side of it. They are high school shop teachers.
But I mean for the marine end of things.
There are some teachers who are already doing some of that, a few. And teacher training, we do have funding for a really outstanding teacher trainer who's going to be available this year to go around and help those teachers figure out what else do you have to do here. You've got, there are some really great teachers in this state. There's a lot of really average ones that can become good by getting some training. And the beauty of this partnership, Scott knows a little more about it, is we do a whole industry validation piece so that then when they're getting their training, they know this is what these companies want. That's a huge confidence boost to them.
When Tacoma canceled their marine science,
yes,
the guy who was teaching that is superb. I don't know what he's doing.
Yeah.
He's a good teacher.
We've heard about this. There's apocryphal, some apocryphal and real tales like that of places where there's equipment. They bought the stuff to try to do this, and it fell apart. They didn't recruit enough kids, or they didn't.
If you're ever interested, I can sit down.
I'll give you my card.
But interestingly enough, at the same time, we're doing Sea Scouts down there. We've got one of the largest programs in the United States with kids on the water.
Yeah.
We sent 3 kids to Cal Maritime.
Yeah, isn't that great?
There's one from the Odyssey.
Yeah.
And so.
Fred Hall's retiring down there. I mean, they've got one of the great metals teachers in the state of Washington is in Tacoma. And eventually that's pulling all this stuff together. And our first strategic partnership in all of this was the Washington Industrial Education Technical Association. It's the shop teachers professional group. I've been to their annual convention now 6 years in a row. That's the key. You got to get to teachers or you have nothing. You got a bunch of hot air and people like me standing up here waving our arms.
Are you working with any of the companies in the Maritime with like summer internships for these kids?
We not yet, but we will. The shipyard here has been doing a helper program with the Skills Center here on the peninsula. You got a great welding teacher here, Bella Kovac, who's got family history with the shipyard. And I know they feel really good about that, and they have been placing some of their kids there. There's some L&I issues that we really need to walk through on that. Like I said, Kay was able to work down at Breit Production Tooling, which is a smaller gauge, but you know, pretty similar environment. I mean, basically anything involving ear and lung protection, you're gonna have to be really careful how we do that involving the state of Washington and the employer.
It just seems kind of natural
for Maritime. Oh, absolutely. One of the exciting things with Peter, to be able to have the kids go help out with the boat show. Yeah. Stuff like that, just for a kid, well, for anybody, that if you love boats, that's just a terrific experience.
Well, if you're in a service marina, you have all kinds of possible positions for those kids.
Yes.
And if you have the services available, you have, the fiberglass stuff going on with repairs.
Yep. Where are you located?
Dig Harbor.
Dig Harbor, okay. Pierce County Skills Center in Bethel is just doing a beautiful job with this stuff, and there might be some of those kids near where you are. Port Townsend, I'm hoping to go up there this afternoon and have just wonderful ideas and some programs already underway.
Great. Thanks, Dave.
All right. So, my name is Derek Van Dyke of State Parks. I can relate to Kate, the kid who didn't like a literature. He was a science and math guy. Before a couple jobs ago, I was a math and science teacher at working with everything from advanced kids down to, your urban inner city kids. And my best friend was the shop teacher. I don't care if they were the valedictorian of the school or the kid barely making it. The shop class was the classroom that made my science and math come alive. You're probably wondering what State Parks is doing here in this sort of maritime trade presentation. So, working to grow the next generation of boaters. Our mission, I got to do a little bit of time about what our mission is. So you all know me as the boating safety card. That's my official role in the state as the boating education coordinator. I'm in charge of the card. But we're doing more than that. We want to grow the sport of boating. But a little background, we were funded in 73, through the Recreational Boater Safety State Grant Program. The funding comes from federal funding from the Sport Fish and Restoration Fund. So, we're a federally funded program that's, our mission is recreational boating safety. Where we're different from a lot of states, though, is we're truly an injury prevention education program. That is, first and foremost, other states that have programs like ours, and every state has one, many of them are law, police groups. You know, it's all about fish and wildlife and the law in the water. We really take injury prevention and education seriously. You know, so our program areas are, I'll just get to that. Our mission is provide, it's educate the boaters of our state so they know the laws. And we do that through online education, classroom education. So this year we've done almost 50,000 boater education cards. We're at about 220,000 cards to date. Now the reason for that is, boaters aren't very smart, a lot of them. They make a lot of mistakes. You look at the Columbia River here. He got run over by a freighter. He was just on the hog lines on the Columbia. He didn't think he had to move his boat. Well, the shipping line is a shipping lane, okay? This next one, look how close those boats are to there. Now notice the guy holding the little girl up there, and none of them are wearing a life jacket. So these are some of the issues as far as boating safety. I'm trying to get to our boaters of our state, which is why we're really pushing our K-12 youth program. We spent a lot of time nationwide trying to get adults to change their habits. Well, it's time to work with youth and create good habits, So, that's this picture here, I think, says it all. Fatality data, we'll get away from this, but this is why my program exists. We're trying to reduce fatality data in our state. The coloration, the bottom blue is human powered. That's a big part of where fatalities are. And then the green is power boats. Let's get into the thing. So moving forward, I've been on the job seven months now, almost 8 months, and we've gone through our strategic planning. So, our goal is to create the best boating safety program in the nation. And we want to do that in a couple ways. So one is we want to become one of the 10 safest states. Right now, historically, we're in one of the 5 most dangerous states to boat in per exposure hour. So, Washington is a dangerous state to be a boater. But 2 and 3 is where I think we fit in here, is we want to have a strong, world-class K-12 program, and we want to grow the sport of boating because we understand the economic impact it has on our state. So this is where the RBS program parks, we're coming in to get a strong K-12 program, and because we understand it's going to grow the whole culture of boating and safety along with it in our state. So, okay, how do we do this? This is the million-dollar question. Well, a strong K-12 plan, and I think it's really important, K-12 plan. Core philosophy you're hearing here is a strong high school plan, but it starts when they're little. We got to funnel them into it, because you can have the best high school program in the nation, but if no one knows about it, it's not going to be successful. So I think it's important. Who are the stakeholders? What are the partners? Whether the industry, the education, whether it be the state in my role, the nonprofits out there like Sea Scouts. There's so many stakeholders that have a value they can add, and we got to collaborate. I mean, that's everything is collaboration. So I look at this pyramid is really critical. So the bottom green is how I think my organization really can step in, is the elementary, the K-5, and the middle school. So with getting we need to expose kids to boating. We need to get them on the water or get them on the docks. And that's where you as the marinas and the boatyards really help me out in that. I want to show you some photos of some things that we've done at marinas. We need to get kids down on the docks, on the water. We need to get curriculum in the school so that we've got this really strong core plus curriculum, but we can't forget about STEM and science and math and bringing in the academic classes as well. So there's a push nationwide of sailing and science. It's been on a long time. U.S. Sailing has a STEM program, and that's something that I take dear. I was fortunate when I was teaching, I took kids out on the schooner Zodiac as a year-end culminating science trip. This was back in 97, 98, 99, so it was pretty early. Risk management was easier then. Okay, they let me do it. But I was talking to the adventurous yesterday. 25 school districts still allow their kids to go out on the water. So it's not like they all are preventing it. So I think that's also where state parks can come in. And me as the safety education coordinators, I need to work with OSPI and school districts on the risk management side that It's not dangerous to be in the water. Frankly, the school bus ride to school is the most dangerous thing that kids are going to ever do in the school, not going on that boat wearing a life jacket that's been Coast Guard certified. So that's not a... And then, you know, the high school core plus, but ultimately at the very top, it's future boaters I'm interested in. I think you are as well. And then people in the maritime careers. You know, part of our mission, really, we want to grow future boaters. More registered boaters, they're going to be safe. The critical mass is going to expand. We're not going to have those people being run over by freighters in the Columbia River. Okay. So this is the Port of Bremerton. A couple months ago, we had 88 fifth graders down in the docks doing with collaboration with the Naval Shipyard, doing STEM activities. Now, which was fun, you'll see in the lower right-hand corner, they're playing with remote submersibles with cameras. So the kids, video games, they were on the dock, walking the docks, in a sense with an underwater video game. They were 100% engaged, they were smiling, they loved, it was most of those kids, first time in a marine environment. So we helped out state parks, we helped them with life jackets, because most marinas don't have 100 life jackets at hand. We can help with that, we can assist with that. Next step is we want to then get them on a boat. So they're coming back in first of the year, the same group of kids, to do a secondary follow-up. What if, after they do the remotes, their underwater cameras, now we get them on a boat like the Comanche and do a tour of the Sound? There's things that we can do to get them on the water to expand that. My marina, West Shore Marina, they host the Gig Harbor Youth Sailing Program. This would be not a school-sanctioned event, but a lot of kids take sailing or kayaking. It gets them on the water. I know my marina, we love the program. They're very clear. The parents don't walk down onto the docks because we don't want everyone to have the code. The boats are at the very, as you walk down the gangplank on the ramp. I know all the tenants there, we love watching the kids go out in their boat and take sailing. And it's a great way for, again, the marinas to engage in the program. Okay, challenges. Before we talk about, there are challenges in doing this in a K-12 program. Stakeholders, effective leadership, lack of interest. People think that there's no interest for maritime. Common Core national standards. This is the big one you're going to hear is, well, we don't have time to do this maritime stuff because we have common standards or Common Core standards we have to teach to. That's easy. We make our program align with those Common Core standards. We give those teachers tools so they can teach through that. Risk management and funding. Well, those first four, they're not an issue. I think there's strong leadership. I mean, what I'm hearing in the room, all of you are here. I was thinking when I took the job 7 months ago, the career piece was something I was thinking 3 years out for my side, because I know it's something that's dear to my heart. When I was working with Dave in the aviation program, I realized how much is happening right now in our state. The leadership is here, the stakeholder groups are together. There's interest. There's no lack of interest. I mean, people are engaged. Hands-on learning is what works. Maritime history in our state is so rich. There's a lot of schools would love to get, you know, kids on the water. Risk management, funding, those are challenges, okay? We can get through the risk management, but that is a real challenge. Funding is always a challenge in the K-12 world. But again, if we create the infrastructure, we create the excitement. I found in the past is, you know, funding seems to always work out when there's a good program. Yeah?
You got a card.
Oh yeah, I have got cards. So again, thanks. That's my contact information. I went really fast. We have some time for questions, but you know, I'm really passionate about you know, education. Say, being a former school teacher, I got young kids in school, and now when I took this job, I saw a great way to mesh my past experience with my joy and love of boating. Because as I think someone said, I grew up, from when I was a young person, learning how to be a safe boater at a young age. So I think we can do great things together. What I ask of the marinas out there is, I would love to work with you on getting kids on your docks and getting pro. Many of you are doing it already, but it's what's coordinated, what's worked together to expand it. You know, I'm talking to the school districts. I was talking to the adventurists. So I was thinking of you, actually, Craig. I know Tacoma schools can't afford to get all their kids on the adventurous, but what we can do is get the adventurous down the Foss Harbor way, and I could help get busing so that every, say every fourth grader does a dock experience. So we can get, you know, 1,200 fifth graders on the adventurous on a dock experience. And that would be an easy way we could connect and do some fun stuff. Yeah. So now, yeah.
So something maybe for all three of you. I also work with the Sea Scouts in Tacoma. I'm on the board of the Tacoma Color Club.
Okay.
This last Tuesday we got to hear from Chip Janichin, who is the Federal Maritime Administrator, Federal Mayor at. He spoke a lot about a lot of things you guys are speaking about, so thank you for the work you're doing. And I'm glad you touched on what I'll call Every Child Left Behind in the core standards.
Yeah.
You know, because that scares a lot of school districts. Through the Sea Scouts, we've tried to have worked with Tacoma School District, and that's been a challenge for them. Really, what do you, and again, this is for all of you, what do you guys see moving forward as ways to overcome some of those challenges? You know, there's, especially on the commercial side, there's schools and programs much like what you guys are already running that funnel people right into the industry. But as you mentioned, it's about getting the younger kids to know that sooner. That way when they get to high school, they haven't been stuck that it's math and science and reading and you have to fill out a bubble sheet and then you just go straight on to college. You know, there's kids not going to college, coming out of an 18-month program, making $200,000 a year in the Gulf of Mexico running a boat. And those are the same guys that are going to buy a boat back home and help this industry. So what do you guys see are ways to overcome those kind of walls?
Well, I mean, I just, okay, one thing.
Yeah, go ahead.
Schools are actually really predictable and easy to work with. They're going to have the same barrier every time. They're going to put up the standards barrier. That, well, we don't have time. We've got these high-stakes tests. We've got to teach to the new core standards, which everybody, they're unaware of, really, and some, they're still implementing them, the new science standards. If you come in with a curriculum that is tied to it, that you demonstrate that this is how you achieve it, you put a bow on it, you have some training that goes along with it, and then if you could find them some additional funding, they're eating out of your hands. So that way, schools are very predictable. So we're talking like STEM. STEM is a big thing right now. So I'm in talks with USA Sailing about they want to have a STEM and sailing component here in the Northwest. Well, there's some money that comes with that and some curriculum. So all of a sudden, schools are going to be interested. But if we're going to have to connect the dots to the core standards for them. They're not going to do it for us. We have to do it for them.
Right.
I think that's...
Well, and just to reinforce what Derek's saying, and back to your question, the car dealers have done a wonderful job of working with high school kids, just having them on the lot, washing off cars, doing things that a new course deal can never have an 18-year-old doing. So one of the things for work-based learning, you guys might be in a really good position to be able to kind of replicate with us what the car dealers did to give kids that experience, because they don't have to go do some, you know, super involved thing. You're trying to capture their imagination. And to reinforce what Derek said, I think to keep within the footprint of what the schools have already approved, so you're not taking on that battle, and exactly what he's saying, adapting to that. Show them that you're the way they're going to teach math and science.
Do you see a challenge now that Washington State has lost its waiver for the No Child Left Behind Act?
I don't, because so much of this stuff depends on what the fellow was saying before. Number one, you got to have a teacher. I'd say go find the teacher first. They're going to go sell the principal on doing it. That's way better than us trying to convince the superintendent that he should talk a principal into finding a teacher. And then it's just, you never get there. You die on the vine. It's taken us 9 years to get to this point. And so I think you just keep burrowing into what's already there, what works, make it bigger, make it better, stronger.
Well, and then to go on that as well is so often education, they've done this top-down approach where someone in Olympia or someone in the Fed say, you will do this, where the most sustainable programs are bottom-up. So one other thing that we're doing at Parks, which is kind of fun, is we're in the formation of starting a teacher committee, sort of a stipend out there to get some, we did this back in the area education program. And it works is there's great teachers out there that are creative, that have interest in maritime. So you give them a little bit of resources, a little bit of grants to help them implement the program and say, you create some, you know, common core curriculum around, give them parameters of A through Z, you know, must fit in the box. But then you get your champions in school districts, and then you get success stories, then you get, you know, a boat and the newspaper involved. And all of a sudden, the principal's like, well, I want more of that.
Yeah.
right? Success breeds success.
Yeah.
So we start at the school, you know, create champions. And it takes a little bit longer to do it that way. But in the end, we have something that's sustainable.